Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints. My special co-host today is Joan Willshire, and we have a heartwarming story, I think, that'll touch everybody at home today. My guest is Phil Krinkie, CEO of the Snelling Companies in St. Paul, and it's going to be 94 years old about next year. So it's been around a long time, but if you read the St. Paul Pioneer Press about Veterans Day, it told a story about they helped out a gentleman who had a mental illness and so forth and so on that needed a new air conditioner and furnace, and the Snelling Companies made that possible. We're going to tell that story in a few minutes. Phil is here today, and I'm honored because he's not only the CEO of Snelling Companies, he's a friend of mine. So I'm honored to know him. Joan, who's your guest today?
Well, we've got a really fun piece here today. We're basically talking about Wicked, the musical that is just out now in theaters. So I've got a couple of different guests. We've got, Amanda Smith and Tim Riker, and they are both from the Deaf Community Support Center, and they're going to be talking about some of the support programs that they utilize when they basically take individuals who are deaf and hard of hearing out into the community, into movie theaters and so forth. And then I also have another guest that'll talk about from the actor as a person with a disability. Alison Bergblom Johnson is with us. So it's a packed little 15 minutes, but it'll be a lot of fun, and broomsticks and witches hatches will be all abundance.
Well, we know if you watch TV at home that Wicked has been billboarded pretty hard by Xfinity.
Right.
So watch
yep.
the commercial.
Great fun.
Mentioned a couple times. So it'll be an action-packed half hour, and we'll be back to start it off in just a couple minutes. Stay tuned, please.
No, we are not celebrating Halloween here on Disability Viewpoints, but what we are celebrating is the new movie, Wicked, the musical, because they actually have hired a person with a disability as one of the actors who actually has a disability. And this is pretty unique. Throughout the years, it's been very well established that many of the actors play the role of disabled actors, and they didn't actually have a disability. So today we're going to talk about some of these issues of basically looking at the actors that have disabilities and how that makes them feel and what it's like to be out there acting in this world as a person with a disability. So with me today, who's going to talk about this with me, is Alison Bergblom Johnson. She's an independent artist. So welcome, Alison.
Thank you so much, Joan. I'm really glad to be here, really excited to talk about Wicked. As an artist, I have done projects with myself and other members of the disability community via Mixed Blood Theater, Whispering Bird for the Arts, and the Walker Art Center. I've done lots of organizing and visibility increasing for myself and other disabled artists. I get emails from casting directors trying to find disabled artists to cast in film. Something happened around 5 or 6 years ago that has really shifted in terms of what are funders' priorities and representation, what does audience care about, what do actors care about, and theaters and movie makers are realizing that they will get called out if they ask a white person, for instance, to play an Asian character. They also intersectionally are realizing, oh yeah, that applies to disability too. And as they're realizing that, then the question is, how do they do the supports? How do they make it work?
Wow. So you're seeing that already. And so is it kind of a new phenomenon, or just something that's been around?
I think it's new. I think one of my hypotheses as an artist and someone who's been making art in a variety of ways since like 1987, which, you know, understand I was a younger person than I am now, but I've been in the arts mm-hmm. for a very long time. I believe there have always been disabled artists. However, most disabled artists are attempting to pass,
right.
which I don't want to fault anyone individually for. And it also means that sometimes the people who are in charge don't know what accommodations are needed, and it makes it seem more fragile mm-hmm. and more of an individual who's done something no one else can. I think what's exciting about some of the pushes for different infrastructure, including I've heard of training programs for disabled artists to sure. bridge into film. These small changes are making it more durable and hopefully more lasting. Mm-hmm. I know that funders care a lot more about representation outwardly and right. inclusion. And I know that there are political changes, but I also don't think mm-hmm. that interest will change. And primarily it's because when a work authentically portrays everyone, people show up to see it with a right. lot more interest.
Right.
And then that becomes not just like an equity argument, but a right. monetary pocketbook.
Right.
This is a better product. This sure. is a more efficient product.
Well, let's jump in and talk about the actual movie. What did you think about the movie?
I loved it. I was so into it. I found it so energizing. I obviously just love Elphaba. I saw myself in many of the characters.
Right.
Sometimes I can be a Galinda too.
Right.
I also felt with Nessa that she just seemed very much herself.
Yep.
And
exactly.
very comfortable on camera. The plot points related to her felt very authentic,
mm-hmm.
including someone trying to help someone who didn't need help.
Sure.
And also, I was a little bit disoriented where the scenes are taking place in castles and old buildings that I know have lots of stairs.
Right.
By looking at me, I'm sure you can see that I have some kind of visual issues which relate to my migraines. I also have psychiatric diagnoses related to PTSD and a few other things.
Sure.
I also have very severe arthritis in my left foot, which means that I can't mm-hmm. always do stairs. I especially can't go down them. So I'm paying attention to that as I navigate the world.
Right.
I noticed that Nessa was included in every space that was filmed in.
Sure.
However, we see other characters go upstairs and downstairs.
Right.
And I have no idea how they built an elevator out of nowhere for her.
Right. Oh. Well, it was a fast-moving movie, lots to see in all the different scenes, that's for sure. So basically, you liked the movie, which is great, and you brought some great perspectives for us to think about as we look forward to future movies with people with disabilities actually being the actors as well. Our time is up and it's really short, but again, Alison, it's been great to have you on just to give you your perspective as a talented, longtime person acting as a person with a disability. So thank you so much for coming on to Disability Viewpoints.
Thank you so much, John.
Next up, we're going to be talking to a group of individuals. Continuation on with the musical Wicked, and to find out how they are working with individuals who are deaf and deaf and hard of hearing as they look to do different events and needing accessibility accommodations and so forth. With me today, we've got Amanda Smith and Tim Riker, and along with two interpreters as well. And Tim and Amanda are with the Deaf Community Support Center, DCSC, and it's under the Keystone Interpreting Solutions. So welcome, both of you. Now,
thank you. Thank you for having us.
Great. Well, I'm so glad you were able to come by and via Zoom and talk about this important musical. One of the things that is unique about Wicked Musical is that they've actually have one of the characters who not only plays a person with a disability, but is a person with a disability. So it's unique because I think for years we've seen in many movies, sitcoms, et cetera, where people are just playing the role of a disabled person and they're not actually a person with a disability. So I'm just curious, when you heard about this movie and that there was a real person in here with a real disability, what did you think about it? I'll have Amanda go first.
Sure. Well, I'm happy to share my thoughts. My first thought, honestly, was finally, someone is willing to give a role of a disabled character mm-hmm. to a disabled person. Mm-hmm. They could absolutely do the same thing as, in my case, it would be a deaf person playing a deaf person instead of a hearing person. Someone who has actually experienced that life as a human being mm-hmm. instead of just like putting on a show and pretending.
Right.
We can always tell. We can see, hey, that's not how we do things in real life. It also takes away from job opportunities of actors with disabilities.
Right.
Because right. we know that actors will often require accommodations. For example, if they hire a hearing actor to play a deaf person, mm-hmm. they don't need to hire an interpreter for that actor.
Exactly. Right.
But when we heard that Wicked had a disabled person in that role, we were thrilled. We were right. very excited to hear right. that because that's what's going to make the movie good is the authenticity there. And sure. it was a beautiful movie. Amazing.
Right. Tim, what are your thoughts on this?
Well, I always think that people say we want to include people from the disability community just by providing them access to it, which is really just a small part of the bigger picture. When people make events and movies that are truly inclusive, they have things that are representative of the community at large. Mm-hmm. Just having access to watch something is part of it, but then there's a whole other aspect of being behind the scenes that people in the disability community have often been disconnected from. And this is a way that we can show that there is a better way to have a mm-hmm. relationship between actor and character. Particularly when it comes to the deaf community, hiring actors mm-hmm. who are not deaf, who are not proficient in sign language for a role right. that would require it, it sticks out like a mm-hmm. sore thumb right away to those who are familiar with it.
Right.
We have a particular way of moving our hands that is more fluid. The eye contact is very sure. specific. So the community can tell right away when the actor is not from our community. And like Amanda said, that authenticity is really crucial to seeing that lived experience coming through the screen sure. and through that role. Right. So I really appreciated it.
Yeah. Well, as I said earlier, this we're breaking the segment up in a couple of different pieces. Short little snippets here, and I appreciate both your perspectives, Amanda and Tim, just to really get the word out about how it does make a difference. Representation does matter of who's real person with disability. So I want to thank you both for being a part of Disability Viewpoints and coming on to talk about this cool Wicked musical. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having us. Thanks.
Welcome back to Disability Viewpoints. It's my honor today to introduce you to a good friend of mine, Phil Krinkie, who is CEO of the Snelling Companies in St. Paul. Some 94 years ago, his family started this company, and I had the good fortune of meeting Phil's dad and then him and so on and so forth. And Phil has engineered the company or manned the company to
keep up with this legendary service in heating and air conditioning for almost 94 years. So let me at this time introduce its CEO of the Snelling Companies, Phil Krinkie. Welcome, Phil.
Great to be here, Mark, and appreciate the opportunity to share a little bit about what we do and how we do it.
And you do it well. What constituted me on this story, I picked up the St. Paul Pioneer Press about Veterans Day and read the story on how the Snelling Companies helped out a gentleman who was having some mental difficulty, needed a new air conditioner and a furnace, and the Snelling Company stepped in and put it in free of charge. Now, they can't do that for everybody, so don't start calling his number now, but for some people that can help out, and they did. And I want Phil to tell the story because it really hit a chord with me. And Phil, welcome again to the show.
Well, thank you. We try to help out at least one or two veterans a year with new heating or cooling equipment. And as you well know, veterans are pretty self-sufficient individuals. Mm-hmm. They've served our country. They've done amazing things in many places around the world. And so we had a contact. A gentleman lives in St. Paul, and his current wife had written in and said that he had sort of run out of magic tricks to keep his furnace running. And the great individual, he was a former Marine, and he actually was living in the house that his great grandfather built, some of the recent housing stock in St. Paul. But so the gentleman, we talked to him, and no question, he needed a new furnace, and we were able to also include with that air conditioner through the help of Lennox Industries. They supply the equipment, both furnace and air conditioner, and then we supply the labor and do the installation. So great gentleman, a tremendous story about his challenges. And actually, he was had just been released from prison and moved back to St. Paul from Texas several years ago to help his father, who was failing in health. And so that's the situation that we were able to step in and help he and his family out.
Yeah, it has to be a great feeling. I mean, in business, you hear a bunch of negative complaints before you hear something good, and this is something good, and I wanted our public here to know about it. And it's just the great things that you do. And I just, the whole article was well written and well done. Whatever got you to think about doing a program like this?
Well, number one, Lennox, probably 10, 12 years ago, started this program, throughout their dealer network. And it's expanded from working in Wisconsin to actually throughout Minnesota. And what we have done is we've looked to help veterans in particular, just because, again, these are people who've served our country, and for the most part, the individuals that have struggles and challenges, just like so many people. But again, as you know, from the disabled community, so many times they're shy, they're self-sufficient, they don't want to impose on individuals or other people in the public.
That's exactly right.
And so, as I said, when we find an individual like Mr. Ryerson, who was in need, yes, you're exactly right, going to help him was truly an honor and a privilege, recognizing his challenges. As I said, living in a house that he grew up in as a child and now lives in, and of course needs, like a lot of houses, needs a lot of maintenance, needs support from the community.
Right.
So that's what, as I said, we want to do, is we want to try to help individuals who have served our country, who've been in the military, and now need help, need something, just a helping hand to make their living arrangements easier and more comfortable.
Now, we don't want to insinuate that you should call the Snelling Company and say, hey, I think I need a new furnace or air conditioner, and how do I get with that program? They have a real program that there's a prerequisite that you have to meet
right.
to get it.
And exactly.
You might want to tell us about
well,
that.
Well, exactly. It's the program is called Feel the Love. It's run nationwide by Lennox Industries through their dealer mm-hmm. network. And so we, yes, take nominations, mm-hmm. people who send in their request or their need, and we forward them then to Lennox Corporation down in Dallas, Texas, and then there's a vetting process, and then we have the permission to go out and to do our part of the work, which is install
right.
the equipment.
Right.
And so, as I said, it's
And that is because it happened in our market.
Yes. So, as I said, we service the Twin City area, but our focus really is in St. Paul. That's where I grew up. That's where...
I've tried to grow up.
Yeah. Well, you mentioned the company that actually the business was started by my grandmother mm-hmm. in the early 1930s mm-hmm. when obviously there was people were heating their homes with coal in those days, and so... she went out, started knocking on doors, selling people coal. So again, at 90 plus years, and we've been very fortunate with a great community and a great workforce to be able to meet people's needs and keep them warm in the sub-zero temperatures that we get in Minnesota.
Yeah. So and cool in the summer.
Yes. Well, yeah. my father many years ago said that if you live in Minnesota, one thing you're always going to need is heat. And that's still true today as it was many decades ago.
Some things just don't change. If there's anything you want to tell our public as far as, I don't know, furnace or air conditioning maintenance, I'm sure you have programs that people can call and sign up for.
Well, the one thing we always remind people, particularly this time of year, is change your furnace filter.
Right.
So that's the simplest and easiest
Number
thing.
Number one, yeah.
Yeah, simplest and easiest thing that you can do to maintain your heating and cooling equipment, and you know, we're still an old-fashioned company. We still answer the phone. So
absolutely,
a lot of people today, you go to an answering service, you go to a voicemail.
Yeah.
But we still believe in answering the phone and talking to people one-on-one.
I can attest to that. I've called over there, and it's the greatest thing is to communicate. And let's not forget that. And also, just realize that if you ever have an air conditioner heating problem, Snelling Companies will always be there, so we'll hope you call them. And I want to thank you for what you did for our community this Veterans Day. I think it's above and beyond, and I think it's great, and I hope you'll continue. And I know with the leadership that you've shown your company, it'll go on to be great as it always is. So thank you, Phil, for all you've done.
Thank you, Mark. A pleasure to be here.
Okay, and that's our show for today. We hope, like I say, we hope we'll see you in year number 27. We'll probably be down at the House and Senate the next time you see us, but we'll be reporting back with bringing back our legislative updates. So stay tuned. It's going to be a big session because it's a budget year. And the best to everybody, and thanks for watching. I'm Mark Hughes for the entire team at SBNN. Bye for now. Hey, welcome back to Disability Viewpoints. And even in his busy time, Santa Claus has decided to stop by our studio today at Disability Viewpoints and see us. Santa, how are you?
I'm great, but I'll get better.
There you go. And how, I know you're busy, and how, what, you're preparing the reindeer and all your toys and getting
well,
ready to go on your...
Well, the reindeer got some weight over the summer season, and they're in training. They don't take off a few more pounds, we'll never get off the ground.
Great. And how big a route do you have now? Where do you go?
Oh, I go all over the world and parts of Wisconsin.
There you go. And what do you want to tell all the boys and girls senior year?
Oh, boy. Be very, very careful this year and be happy with everybody mm-hmm. and make sure that you mind your mom and pop, and you'll be good for the rest of the year, believe me.
And what are the stops around the area you're going to be making before you get going on your Christmas route?
Oh, I'll be at some daycare centers, some senior centers.
Great.
And in saying hi to people, I got a few house parties that I've been invited to.
Great.
They're always fun.
Yeah. And I know you're the life of the party, so that's not the problem.
Well, it's a good thing that I still have a life to have a party.
There you go. And anything you want to say to the boys and girls before we go?
Well, you know, if you haven't sent your list in to Santa, make sure you get it there so I have an idea of what you want for Christmas. The more mail that I get, the easier it is to dish out the toys and all the other goodies that people want.
Oh, good. And you know how to send that to care of Santa Claus at the North Pole?
Yes.
And he'll be sure to get it.
Yes.
All right. We'll be back with more Disability Viewpoints right after this. Well, we had a lot of exciting things happen today. Santa stopped by. Phil Krinkie, CEO of Snelling Company, stopped by and told a heartwarming story. We hope if you ever need service, you'll remember the Snelling Companies, please. And Joan Willshire, how did your guests go today?
Well, the three guests were fabulous, as we were talking about. Wicked the Musical, and having the person with a disability actually be the actor with a disability as well. So special thanks goes out to Amanda Smith, and then, of course, Tim Riker, and then also Alison Bergblom Johnson, the actor with a disability. So it was fun, and, you know, we're all going to get our witches' hats and on our broomsticks and go out and see the movie again.
Well, very good. And that closes out our 26th year on Disability Viewpoints. Thanks, SBNN Studios. And in January, when we get back, we'll be talking about what's going to go on at the legislature and the 2025 legislation, and talking, it's a budget year, so it'll be interesting. And you know the election results already, so that'll be interesting as well. So join us next year as we begin our 27th year here on Disability Viewpoints. Before we go, thank you very much for watching at home. We'll see you soon. Bye for now.